Welcome back to the Missing Maura Murray podcast. Lance, how are you tonight?
Doing really well. How are you?
Doing good. And this episode is brought to you by Hunt-A-Killer, a brand new game. You got to hear about it. It's coming up in a little bit. This episode is kind of different. It's almost, we're almost hearkening back to the old days of MMM when it was just me and Lance. We were breaking down articles, breaking down things that we've read about the case.
Things that we knew, things that we thought we knew. And we had a conversation earlier on about the fact that we do reference articles a lot, but we really should get into these articles. So that's what we're going to do. There are articles that were written right after Maura disappeared. There's information in there that has sustained through the years, and there's information that has been contradicted through the years. So very interesting stuff here, and frankly, a little overdue.
So we want to give a big thanks to our buddy Dan, who sent us some of these articles. And you may remember Dan from the UMass Cabin episode.
We went in on a Monday morning to be induced the day after the due date. And my girlfriend was in the bed getting the on-demand nitrous oxide while I'm sitting in the corner on my phone looking up Maura Murray information online, trying to...
In the delivery room.
Yes, sir.
I love that.
I am not upset.
That's amazing.
Thanks a lot, Dan. And also on this episode, we're going to bring in an old friend of mine and a journalist who's written a couple of articles about Maura Murray's disappearance. His name is Chris Peek. How's it going, Chris?
It's good. It's good to be with you guys again.
I guess Chris and I aren't friends, so I'll introduce myself.
Of course we are.
I know. I just heard Tim say an old friend of his.
Well, I went to high school with him.
Maybe we're new friends. We're new friends. Yeah, we're new friends. Okay.
You know, Lance follows and unfollows me on Twitter, so sometimes it's tough to figure out where you stand with him.
I unfollow you?
I think over the past year, you followed and unfollowed me a half a dozen times.
Really?
Which is fine. Yeah, I'm not upset about it. I was just...
I think that just happens. I feel like that's happened to me with certain people too. But I can't imagine Lance is seriously following you and unfollowing you. It's almost like the poke feature on Facebook.
that's really interesting. And I apologize if there was any... maybe I have the random follow unfollow feature setting on you.
Sure, Twitter. Yeah.
And you have that great McDonald's tweet there on your banner. Nice.
I'm just depressed overall about that whole thing. So
it's exhausting.
I know.
You're talking about politics.
I am, yes.
So have you been writing any articles about politics lately?
I have, yes. But
okay. Anything you want to share real quick before we get into this?
The whole fake news thing that we've been dealing with for the past, I don't know, what, 8 or almost a year since the campaign started. I've actually noticed, just talking to family, like my family's actually getting smarter because they're having to fact check everything now. Like I would always have to kind of introduce them to, you know, what's going on, or, you know, the Congress is doing this, or, but now I find that my mother is like emailing me about, hey, are you following the Gorsuch hearing? So I just feel like, you know, with the way that things turned out, and of course, you know, hearing fake news about 100 times a day, that you know, for a while, people were a little depressed about, you know, maybe the country is just full of a bunch of, you know, dummies. But I kind of think, and you know, I'm a pessimist by heart, but I kind of think that that all of this, you know, rhetoric and fake news stuff is kind of making us smarter. Like we're having to do the hard work and to actually read stories that aren't just on Facebook. So
read more than headlines and then fact check those stories that you read. Yeah.
Go beyond what your, you know, second cousin liked on Facebook and actually try and figure out, oh, is this actually true?
Yeah, I totally noticed that, but I guess I never really thought about it until you said it. And it's also bringing, as bad as the situation is, I have never seen the country be more united for causes that are humane.
Well, people who have never been into politics before have been activated recently.
Right. And of course, that can be a bad thing. Thankfully, I'm not on Facebook. But, you know, unfortunately, I've seen some of the things that family members have been posting on Facebook. So, you know, having an active aunt on Facebook isn't the best thing, but hopefully there's more coming out now that can kind of say like, oh, and now we have Facebook with their new kind of fact-checking app or whatever the hell you want to call it, that's actually going to now list whether or not this
is from an accredited website or not. Yeah.
Now, Peek, before we get all political here and alienate half our audience, let's just slow down. We're going to talk about Moriamari, but tell everyone what publications you've written for.
So I've written for Elite Daily, Good Magazine, Point Magazine, The Colonel, Huffington Post, Gawker. So a bunch of sites that I guess people tend to read.
Okay. Well, I think it's important to have you on for this episode because we are talking about these old articles and we wanted to get the perspective of someone like you, a journalist, who can see how things can go awry either naturally or some kind of spin. So you can help us break these inconsistencies down and these oddities that we're going to find in these articles, and we're going to find out if they're really odd or if they're really inconsistencies or how they could have happened.
And we often talk about the group of people that help us behind the scenes, and occasionally we have them on, and Chris Peek is one of those people who will email us frequently, and just recently have we decided to have him on. So there's always the gears are always in motion, the machine is always working behind the scenes.
So Monday, February 9th, 2004, mostly cloudy, slight chance for snow showers, lows 18 to 23 with a south to southwest wind less than 10 miles per hour. This is from February 9th, and it's talking about the night, February 9th.
And to get into that, the next day was very similar weather overnight, lots of clouds, intervals of sun, chance of some snow flurries, that's on Tuesday. Highs in the low 20s, so overnight we're talking 10 to 20s.
First article we have here was printed Thursday, February 12th, written by Gary E. Lindsley. The article appeared in the Caledonian Record.
And Gary Lindsley was the foremost reporter on this case. Again, we're not talking about a city of 200,000 people and five newspapers. So, but
right, but he wrote a lot of articles on the case.
Most of them, yeah.
The second paragraph in this article says the woman, Moriamari of Hanson, may be suicidal, according to a press release issued by Police Chief Jeffrey Williams.
Right, this is the police asked for help finding missing woman. Yeah, second paragraph after introducing a 21-year-old Massachusetts woman says she might be suicidal. That's according to Chief Jeffrey Williams. Is that responsible?
I never like to nitpick something that's been said or written that's certainly over a decade old, right? So there's stuff that I've written that I would hope wouldn't be dissected 10 years from now. But I think with this press release, and it was such a misstep in some ways, it actually makes sense that they would have come out with this release, because it sort of lays the groundwork for a police department that was, in the end, I don't think anybody would disagree, they were really over their heads with her disappearance. So it kind of makes sense that the very first thing that they would come out with is something that really wasn't factual, and that, you know, she could have been suicidal.
Right. Now I wonder where he got that from.
There's some speculation as to whether he got that from what Fred Murray said, right?
Right.
Interesting. All I'm saying, I'm not trying to put words in anybody's mouth or theorize or speculate on anything. It's interesting, though, right? Because we don't know that. We don't know that Jeffrey Williams got this information from something that he heard Fred say.
Right. And we also feel pretty strongly, I think, at this point that Fred has said over and over over the years that
He thinks Mora was met with foul play by a local dirtbag. So yeah, he may have said he thought she might have been suicidal at one point very early on, but he definitely has changed his tune. Is it something he said so the police would keep looking, or is it something he really believed? Because to me, it seems like he really believes that.
I completely agree. If he were to say that by declaring somebody suicidal, what's the law on that? When do they stop looking for somebody? If they've been kidnapped, abducted, then it becomes more of an urgent matter. Suicide isn't so much of an urgent matter.
Right. So he has some motive in lying about it, saying, oh, she might have been suicidal if he knew something, and then saying, oh, actually, no, I was wrong with that. But at this point, I mean, so I don't know what happened back in 2004 with him. But at this point, he does not believe she committed suicide. She has not been found in 13 years. A person who committed suicide, most bodies are found, especially if it's not in water, which it could have been, I guess, because there was a river nearby.
Yeah, this conversation reminds me of the, like you said, the early days of doing this podcast, where I start getting that like pit of my stomach anxiety and a little bit of, you know, I'm getting a little angry about the whole thing. Like, why would you put this in an article? To the second paragraph in an article, immediately this article is dismissed by most people after they read that. The woman, Mora Murray of Hanson, may be suicidal, according to the police chief. So reading that, I mean, I'm going to probably start reading about something else, because I don't want to read about the sad story of the girl who went into the woods and she's suicidal. I'm getting those old feelings back again.
Well, Dan highlights the very last line in this article. He says, police believe Murray may be headed to the Kankamangas Highway. And he says that is sort of an odd thing, or stood out to him. And it's a good point. I don't know why that would be in there, unless they're just taking Fred's word for it that Mora was headed to Bartlett.
It feels like a lazy bit of, like, an empty piece of reporting to me.
Yeah.
They just kind of chose the most popular route that goes through that area, the Kankamangas Highway, and she may have been heading that way. It just feels lazy to me. What do you think?
Yeah, it could be lazy. It could also be just the reporter trying to set an early tone for the story or later. You know, he could also just have been trying to personalize the story and the area, knowing who his readers were, and sort of, you know, making that connection with, you know, certainly a highway known to New Englanders. And it could also just have been the reporter taking a creative liberty and adding some meat to the story, right? Just filling up a page with some words or conjecture, even if there was no direct evidence that that's where she was headed. Right, there's always, you're always trying to connect in some way to the reader, and as long as you're not fudging lines or, you know, getting too deep into speculation, I don't really, you know, find anything wrong with it. I don't think this is necessarily something about being lazy over a reporter just trying to fill up a page, right? Like he may have had another 200 words to write, and sometimes those last few hundred words are the most difficult. So I wouldn't call it lazy. I would call it fluff.
Just to read a little bit some of these articles, here's one from the next day, February 13th. Here's a bit of it. Witnesses who saw the accident told police they had seen a lone woman. They also said that it didn't appear the woman had been injured in the accident. When they asked if she needed help or the police, she reportedly said no. She left the scene before police and EMS arrived. Police said Mora may be suicidal and headed towards the Kankamangas Highway. Again, that same line in the very next article. Fred Murray says he does not understand what prompted his daughter to leave the University of Massachusetts in Amherst, where she is a nursing student, to drive to New Hampshire. He said it is very unusual for her to just take off. He had seen her on Sunday afternoon and didn't suspect anything was wrong. And here's the quote. I don't know exactly what you think is the matter. It isn't anything that can't be easily solved. And that was Fred Murray pleading to his daughter through the media.
And that quote there has become something of folklore at this point. Anything that we can do more, this is me, like always, we will solve this. This isn't anything we can't that can't be easily solved. I'd say that's a pretty clever piece of writing right there to make sure that they put that in there. Pretty clever piece of writing, because imagine this. Let's say that they do think that somebody kidnapped Maura, and they're going to put out the story that she might have been suicidal. So maybe maybe I'm giving the police more credit than they deserve, but perhaps they contacted Gary Lindsley and said, keep pushing the suicide thing, and we're going to keep pushing Fred Murray begging for his daughter and using her name in there, and hopefully someone reads it and someone comes forward out of guilt or pressure, or you know, maybe feeling too comfortable that they're getting away with it. Is this some sort of tactic? I don't know. Is he just trying to get readers to sympathize with the family? Perhaps. Now, at the end of the article that we're talking about, which was on the 13th of February, 2004, this is the first time that it's at least published for public consumption that Kathleen Maura's sister called Fred, their father, on Tuesday from Maura's apartment. We always hear that Kathleen called Fred and told him about the disappearance because she was contacted by the authorities first. This is the first time that Kathleen's name is mentioned, saying she called him Tuesday from Maura's apartment. And apartment, I'm assuming, is the college dorm. I don't think a lot of people realized that Kathleen was in Maura's dorm and made that call from there.
Okay, that moves us on to February 18th, 2004, another article from the Caledonian Record written by Gary E. Lindsley. Quote, the search has gone nationwide, said Haverhill Chief Jeffrey Williams in a phone conversation. Williams's four-person police department, which includes himself, has been investigating this disappearance. They, along with detectives from New Hampshire State Police, Troop F, have been receiving leads all over New England. A resident who lives near the accident scene told police Murray was asked if she wanted police or emergency medical services called. She reportedly said no. That was the last time anyone had seen the young woman who reportedly crashed her father's vehicle 2 days before she crashed her own car.
I find it interesting that it's pointed out that Williams has a four-person police department, which includes himself. So he's got three deputies on the police force in this town. And the state police come in from Troop F, and now they're receiving leads from all over New England. The date on this was February 18th. So in just a few days, in 4 days, 5 days, it's gone from suicide to tips all over New England.
Right. And there's more from Williams. He says, quote, we don't know if someone picked her up. We are certainly concerned about that. We are getting leads from all over New England. It's a national investigation at this point. Williams wouldn't comment concerning what the witnesses had said about Murray's disappearance between the time of the accident and the time officers arrived.
Tim, you know why you've been calling me and I haven't been answering? You've been shooting me a lot of text messages.
No, I'm really wondering, actually. I'm kind of upset about it.
You know, you received it in the mail, this Hunt-A-Killer thing.
Oh, that's what it is. Yeah. Oh, it's incredibly fun. I don't blame you for not calling me back. I'm boring compared to Hunt-A-Killer.
I would never sell you short as boring, but you really are. I can't put you up against Hunt-A-Killer. We need to talk to our audience about this, because our listeners, this is not lip service. Our listeners are in this genre. They need to experience this. I want to take a second to tell everybody about this new subscription box service called Hunt-A-Killer. Maybe they've heard about it. I don't know, but people are obsessed. I'm obsessed. Tim, I think you're obsessed with this. You were talking about this earlier on as well. Hunt-A-Killer sends a package to your home each month full of creepy correspondence from a killer curator. He's a little like Hannibal Lecter, and he's got a mystery for you to solve.
Each month you will receive new clues, letters, articles, objects, tools, all adding to an ongoing murder mystery. And it's up to you to solve it, along with the thousands of other members all working together in our online communities. It's the perfect thing for an armchair detective looking to put their sleuthing skills to the test.
And you can join by logging onto huntakiller.com and applying for membership. Huntakiller is growing so fast. Listen to this. They have to limit new members to 500 a week. Once you apply and you are approved for membership, you will receive a private link to subscribe. Then a package arrives at your door each month. The waiting, honestly, is the hardest part.
Tom Petty said. They've been featured in BuzzFeed, Fast Company, and Bustle. Huntakiller is forming a cult-like community of web sleuths and amateur detectives. If you love poring over creepy codes, ciphers, and clues, Huntakiller is simply perfect. And if it's not for you, I have a feeling you know at least one person that would love to receive it as a gift.
Seriously, I cannot recommend this membership enough. To help support our show, Huntakiller has offered a 10% discount for our listeners, which is tracked to this message. Use the code MISSING and get 10% off. That's MISSING when you go to their website. Interesting in this article is there's a little, what do you call those things? A little sidebar, a little...
Yeah.
A little sidebar in there that says search stagnant, and it's by J.M. Hirsch, Associated Press writer. The investigation into the disappearance of a Massachusetts woman seen more than a week ago in northern New Hampshire has become stagnant, her father said. There's no new leads, no new evidence, Frederick Murray said Tuesday, of the search for Maura Murray, a 21-year-old nursing student who disappeared after a car accident in Woodsville, New Hampshire. It's stagnant at the moment. That's a quote from Fred to J.M. Hirsch of the Associated Press. Now, why would this newspaper put that as a sidebar to the article, within the article, stating that it's gone nationwide and we're receiving leads from all over New England? And then right there within this is a little sidebar that says it's stagnant. What we're seeing here are really the beginnings of the battle between the family and law enforcement.
I guess so. Fred blames the lack of leads on shortage of resources, saying though local police were working hard, he wished the department had more help.
Right, exactly. It's the start of that whole story. It's the story unfolding right there between law enforcement, local law enforcement needing help, Fred realizing it, and inevitably it became the mess that Fred feared right from the beginning, as we can see right here.
And here's some more quotes from Mr. Murray. But you can't get enough evidence because you don't have the force to go out and get it. Do you wait until you have a body to have evidence and you can call the FBI in? Is it possible to expand and pound a little harder? He says, just tell us you're okay. Don't come back if you don't want to. Just tell us you're okay. She would if she could, but I don't think she's able to, for whatever reason that is. End quote.
That was February 18th, 2004.
Yes. And so that was the first time Mr. Murray mentioned the FBI. And so we are still trying to get the FBI to take over this case. So please, there's a petition circling on change.org. You can find the link in the show notes. If you haven't signed the petition, it can't hurt.
Here's something going back to the 18th. On February 11th, a police dog was brought to the scene. I want to break that down. One police dog was brought to the scene. It says a police dog was brought to the scene, but was able to track her for only 100 yards, prompting her family to conclude that she got a ride. A police helicopter and ground search also turned up no evidence. This is where the conclusions are made that after 100 yards, the dogs lost the scent. This is the first time that we see a police dog and tracking her scent and the 100 yards. and the 100 yards in the direction that this dog was, that we now know this dog was searching, was right at Bradley Hill Road.
And also in that article, we have the first mention of alcohol in the car or drank by Mora. Murray was not injured in the accident. However, she was reportedly impaired due to alcohol consumption when she was seen by her car after her accident. So I don't know what that means. It's she was impaired due to alcohol consumption when she was seen by her car. So she was visibly drunk? Is that what that says? Because that's not what Butch Atwood said.
Yeah, I'm not sure if this is some sort of creative license that, Chris, you mentioned before, that someone could take and not realize the implications of it. But we know that Butch, based on these early articles, which we'll get to, we know that Butch said she didn't seem injured, but she seemed shook up. Seeming shook up after an accident and impaired due to alcohol, when Butch really had no reason to think that she was drinking at that point.
Yeah, how do you tell the difference anyway?
Yeah, this is kind of tough, because I would never want to include something that was not factual. And of course, when anybody is writing anything, especially in print, and now, of course, online, you just have to assume that whatever is on the page, the reader is going to assume is factual and true. And I just don't think there's any evidence that Mora was intoxicated. There can't be, because she was never found. And all that the investigators have is a box of wine that was possibly open and stains that could look like red wine. And even if we're talking about sort of speculation, regardless, I would still never want to include something that could possibly implicate somebody doing something illegal when there's no evidence that anything illegal was done. And when it starts to come out that Mora was possibly driving drunk, you have to figure out, okay, where's that coming from? Where's the source? And if the source is the police department, then, well, we have to go as far back as day one with that press release about her being suicidal. Okay, and now we're even talking about the story about her car accident the weekend before at UMass is now public. So there's a bunch of hearsay that is very prejudicial to Mora in the very early stages of this investigation, that, okay, who the source is for this information about Mora possibly being drunk, and why is that information getting out, and then why is that information finding its way into a newspaper? So we've already established that the Haverhill Police Department is in over its head, right? But now it seems like there are dribs and drabs of information that's coming out that isn't necessarily true, and I'm not sure why that ever made it past an editor.
From Detective Scorinza himself, he says, "We are reasonably confident she did not enter the woods near the crash scene. There's no indication someone picked her up. At this point, I have no reason to believe she was taken against her will."
I guess I don't know what the protocol is for what police say and law enforcement says to reporters. John Scorinza took over the case from the state police and downplayed the angle that she was picked up, downplayed Fred's theory, Fred's thoughts about it.
But at this point also, in this exact article, it states that the FBI has been called into the case. And Fish and Game Lieutenant Todd Bogardus, in a press conference at the Haverhill Police Department Thursday, said that three canine teams, two of which were part of the New England Canine Search and Rescue Group and the other from the state police, were unable to come up with any clues. And it says, two of the canines were air scent dogs.
Yep, this is the first time that we've seen it become an actual missing persons case.
Okay, so that's pretty good then. I mean, I remember previously in this podcast saying, well, kind of throwing out the dogs. These dogs got a glove. They got a brand new leather glove that Mora hardly wore. And maybe they got no scent of Mora whatsoever. But it says here that there are two air scent dogs as well. So you would think that between the two different kinds of dogs that something would have come up if there was something other than Mora scent at that spot 100 yards away.
Correct.
Bogardus goes on to say the results today were non-conclusive. We were unable to locate anything within a 2-mile square radius.
And the date on this one is?
February 20th, 2004.
So this is the first time that the public has been informed that the radius is 2 miles and they haven't found anything. They haven't found tracks. They haven't found anything from the dogs. The sense of how it's unfolding comes together with these articles.
Here's another one from Scarinza. We have not asked them to do that, Scarinza said, referring to checking Mora's computer for any information which would help move the investigation along. I'm going to fucking tear my hair out just reading that. Why?
Why haven't they, or why did they even say that?
Yeah, why would they? Both.
Right.
I hope they got on it after this. I hope someone asked someone to do that. And obviously we know that whatever was found in the computer didn't lead to Mora's case being solved. So we can just assume it wasn't all that great. There weren't great leads on there. But don't you find that hard to believe?
I find it hard to believe that Scarinza wouldn't say no comment. I find it so hard to believe that Scarinza, when approached with that question, would say it's part of an ongoing investigation and I cannot comment on that at this time. Instead of, what were the words there?
We have not asked them to do that.
We have not asked them to do that.
Referring to having the FBI check Mora's computer to see if there were any information to where she might have been headed.
It's no wonder people criticize this case and criticize the police force with comments like that. That's a comment that was immediately after the disappearance. A reporter was talking to John Scarinza and he said, we hadn't asked them. We haven't asked them to do that. Just say no comment and then go ask. I mean, you didn't think of that?
Also of note, it says authorities are also conducting background checks of people of interest in the area. Interesting.
Yep.
So when asked why a second ground search and air search was conducted on Thursday, nearly a week and a half after the accident, Scarinza said, "We wanted to make sure we had done everything twice. We have a very good feeling we have done everything we can do at the crash site."
What was the date on that one where he said that there were people of interest?
That's on the 20th.
So Scarinza says on the 20th that there are people of interest that they're questioning in town.
Yeah.
On the 20th as well, he says there's no indication someone picked her up. At this point, I have no reason to. Like, is this guy just like talking?
I think he could think she got into a car, but that could also mean that whoever was driving that could be a person of interest. So it could be both.
I think I'm taking back what I said earlier about the press and the police force using this medium here to make somebody nervous or to put the pressure on somebody. Because if I had done a crime like this and I was reading the papers to find out what the cops are up to, I would either say they have no idea what's going on because they contradict themselves within the same day in an article. And if they're not, then they're overthinking it so badly that I'm going to get away with it either way.
Right, which is why I've said that it was the worst place for Mora to have gone missing, but also with your point, the best place, so to speak, right? Because you have some would say inept police force, inexperienced, over their head. You have a small town paper with probably two or three reporters that might not be
used to covering a now national case, although I'm not sure at the moment whether it was national, but it was just a bad perfect place for her to go missing.
Scarinza, we are on the 20th. We are reasonably confident she did not enter the woods near the crash site. He also said police don't have any indication any harm has come to her. And then he follows up with that line. There is no indication someone picked her up at this point. I have no reason to believe that. So what happened?
So they're going on off the assumption she got into a car, though.
But there's no indication someone picked her up. That's what he says. And there's no indication. Yeah. We're reasonably confident she didn't enter the woods.
Maybe no one, he means picked her up, like, in a nefarious way.
Abducted her?
Abducted her, where he's saying she got into a car willingly. That has to be what he's thinking, right?
It's just painting, It's just painting a very confusing picture that leads to where we're at now. He also said he didn't have any indication any harm came to her. No indication someone picked her up, and she didn't walk into the woods.
And here is Sharon Roush, the mother of Bill Roush, who was Maura's boyfriend. Sharon says, "It's been a long, long 10 days. We are very worried. We believe she is somewhere and someone is preventing her from contacting us. She loved her family and there is no way she would put her father and my son through this." She goes on to say, "Maura, we love you. Don't you give up. We will never give up. We will find you." This next article is your favorite one, Lance. Area man laments the events of February 9th. Missing woman didn't accept his help, by Gary E. Lindsley from the Caledonian Record.
It's always fascinating to hear something from a person who was the last one to see a missing person. Butch Atwood was, as far as we know, the last person to see Maura that night. And this article is written so close to her disappearance, it's about as close to the truth as you're going to get from Butch Atwood. Butch Atwood is no longer with us. He's deceased. There has been enormous rumors about him, and then rumors dismissed, and then the rumors start back up again just based on the next wave of people coming aboard the case and looking into it. But it was always interesting to me that he laments the events of February 9th. He talks about how he understands why she wouldn't have accepted help from him, because he, you know, is a large man with, you know, he's not clean cut. He's got a beard, and he could see how she would get into the car with somebody more clean cut. He also talks about, he saw no blood. She was cold. She was shivering. He never says anything about the alcohol. He told her, he said, I'll call the police. And this whole exchange to me has become, we've almost scripted it. And I don't mean we here. I mean, we as a community looking into the case, we've scripted it as Maura saying in a defiant tone, I called AAA. It really could have been a number of different ways she said this to him. He, I'm going to call the police. She doesn't want the police involved. So she could have said, no, I'm going to call AAA. Maybe she said, I'm going to call AAA. And he interpreted it as, I called AAA. And then that right there seems very insignificant, unless you think she was trying to call AAA. She was trying to get her car out, and maybe she walked to an area to get better service. That's just a, you know, a little, a theory.
Totally. He says, I will make a call to the police department, and why don't you come to my house, get warm, wait for the police and the EMS. She says, no thanks. She's gone in the next 10 minutes. So he tells her he's calling the police, and then she's gone. So yes, she either went to get service to call AAA, but the police were already coming, or she didn't want the police to find her.
Two things that stand out to me in this article that become muddied as the years go on is whether she was inside the car or outside the car. And in this article, it says, Atwood said the Saturn lights weren't on. I shined the light in her car. He said, are you okay? She said she was. Atwood said he got a good look at her. She looked to be about 20 and had dark hair. As a matter of safety, he told her to turn the car lights on so no one would strike her vehicle coming around the curve. And then he goes on to describe how he saw no blood, but she was shivering. This article puts her inside the car. He also goes on to describe his call to 911. He said he drove to his house about 75 yards from the scene of the accident.
Which is also maybe not inconsistent, but if you're saying the dogs lost trace 100 yards from the accident site, and this article is saying Butch's house is 75 from the accident site, you're saying the dogs lost the track 25 yards past Butch's house.
If everything's correct and it's 75 yards from the accident site to Butch's house, then yeah, 25 yards beyond that. So 25 yards beyond Bradley Hill, because Butch lived right across the street from Bradley Hill. So 75 yards up the street. We've been there. You know, you can see that house. He says he backed his bus into the driveway before running to the house to call the police. Which is an interesting descriptor of a man who's over 300 pounds.
Yeah, I can't imagine he was really running, but I think just moving briskly is what the writer means.
Sure. But that came from somewhere, that it wasn't just, oh, I backed in and then went in to call. He couldn't get through to the Haverhill Police Department and the Grafton County Sheriff's Department. This is the first time that we see that he couldn't get through to the police department or the sheriff's department. He called 911 and the operator couldn't get through either. Atwood said that another 911 operator was able to get through. Here's something that is super important. While he was talking on the phone on his front porch, Atwood could see the road, but not Murray's disabled car. He saw several vehicles drive by, but couldn't tell any makes or models. So we always talk about that window of when she was picked up and how it all happened.
So that's the window.
And it just shut a bit because, well, that's the window. So what did he see? What didn't he see? We know that he went back out to his bus, and then Smith came up and he proceeds to search for Mora on his own, driving west towards the Swiftwater stage shop.
Different from the way Mora was driving, which I know is sort of an issue why a lot of people never really searched east that night.
Right, which raises the question, and again, this is hypothetical, what prompted Butch to direct his search west? Was it Officer Smith perhaps indicating that he should search in that direction? We don't know.
On February 21st, there was another article, and there was some talk about what Mora actually wrote to her professors. And it is here in this article that she emailed her professors telling them she'd be away for a week because of a family emergency. Some people have reported that it was that Mora said there was a death in the family, which is not what she said according to this article. And, well, according to Scorinza and UMass police.
Right, and as a matter of fact, there's nothing written in the early days of the disappearance, early days, weeks, and months that specify death. It's always been an emergency. So taken at face value with all of the early reporting and investigating on this, Mora did have a conversation with her sister that caused her to cry at work. Mora did have a family emergency, if we put those two things together, right? Because why would... She's calling, you know, she talks to her sister at work. She starts crying, has a breakdown, has to be escorted back to her dorm. And then says she has a family emergency. Right now, everyone reads that as She said she had a death in the family. I think we might have even said it early on, too. She reported that she had a death in the family, which was not true. So people hear that part. It resonates, right? Which was not true. At face value, it's true. It's all true. It's all there. She said, my sister. She was actually talking to her sister, she broke down because of some family emergency. And she left because of some family emergency. Everyone just dismisses it too quickly now that she was lying about a death in the family. Well, that was never actually said.
So Scorinza says UMass campus police have been interviewing people, including professors and students, since Mari left the university for unknown reasons. Scorinza says it has become pretty clear she hasn't told anyone she was leaving. In reality, she had planned to go. And then there's parentheses that says to Burlington. So apparently they were talking about Burlington and he just didn't finish that sentence with to Burlington. But the writer Gary Lindsley was pretty confident that that's what he meant. So Scorinza was saying that she didn't tell anyone that she was leaving, but she was planning to go to Burlington, Vermont. What the hell was she doing on Route 112 if she was going to Burlington, Vermont?
Doesn't it feel like to you that the police sense that they're losing their grip on this?
Well, Scorinza said it's very frustrating, right? In this a couple of paragraphs before, referring to the lack of information coming in about where Mari could be. Yeah, so they said it. They were.
Yeah.
February 27th, 2004 brings another article from Gary Lindsley. He says that the Mari family has hired an outside investigator to find out what happened to her. Does not state the name of that investigator. We can only speculate at who it might be. I'm sure we've heard the name, probably mentioned the person on the show. More from Sharon Rausch. With all the attention from the media, if a good person had picked her up, he would have come forward. It leads us to believe a bad guy picked her up. I just wish they would treat this as a criminal investigation. If they treated it as such, the FBI could become more involved. Also, this is the first mention that Maura packed up her dorm room. It says UMass Police Department Detective Brian Davies said Mari had packed up all her belongings in her dorm room and appeared to be moving out and not returning. As we've talked about on this podcast, was Maura moving in or was she moving out? The semester had just begun.
And here is the birth of this debate. All of these things we're reading right now is the most of them are the origins of how much information's out there and how quickly and the reasons why it gets all of this white noise comes in. The 7 to 9 minutes is in a Butch Atwood. That comes from Butch Atwood. That's not something that this podcast made up. Right after, when he's talking to Gary Lindsley, Atwood says he invited the woman to wait at his house nearby, but she declined. He said he then went home to call 911. After about 7 to 9 minutes, he looked out and saw a Haverhill police cruiser by the Saturn. Butch Atwood just put the timestamp on it right there. February 27th. Butch Atwood put the timestamp, 7 to 9 minutes, time it takes from him to talk to her, get to his house, run inside, make a couple of phone calls that don't go through, is on his porch, says he can't see the scene of the accident. 7 to 9 minutes, he's in his bus that's backed in, and he can see down there, and he sees Haverhill Police by the Saturn. So Butch Atwood, that's his timestamp on it. Here on the 27th, was it Bill Rausch listened to a voicemail, said what he heard, what he believed to be whimpering and crying. And his original statement was that it was Maura, that he believed it was Maura. Scorinza dismisses that in this article on the 27th, says that angle has been eliminated because investigators traced the calling card to the American Red Cross officials who had been attempting to contact Bill Rausch. Again, whimpering and crying is one thing, and the American Red Cross leaving a message is another. That's still something that is a huge mystery to me.
It's been out there because of the disappeared episode, and they never tie it up. They never mention the Red Cross. So it sounds like that's what it is.
Other than Bill said real early on, within the first couple of weeks, that he had a message from who he believed to be Mora, whimpering and crying.
Yeah, it's true. But if Mora had the ability to call Billy, why wouldn't she have just called 911? Right after that, it says there is also the mysterious phone call Murray received while working as a security person at a residence hall at UMass on February 5th. The call reportedly reduced Murray to tears, and her supervisor had to take her home because she was so distraught. UMass Detective Davies said his department has been able to track the phone call. He says, "We know the location. We have not been able to identify whom she was speaking. Her friends have no idea who called her." And then Sharon Rausch says, "It's obvious to us something has happened to distress her." She said Murray called Bill February 8th and was crying because of the previous Saturday's accident, though he didn't feel that that was it. He told Mora on a scale of 1 to 10, it was only a 3 or a 4. On some kind of crisis scale is what we have to assume, I guess.
Right.
So he was telling Mora that what you're freaking out about right now isn't as big of a deal as you seem to be making it at this hour. But it was also like 4 a.m.
Yeah, and she totaled her dad's new car. I mean, I think he's downplaying it a bit. I think on a scale of 1 to 10 at that particular time in her life, and she totaled her dad's car. Yeah, that's not a 3 or a 4. That's at that particular time, it feels like a 10, right? So
yeah, for her it must have.
Yeah, exactly. And then he said he had to calm her down. He was talking her back, and you know, maybe overall in the grand scheme of life, yeah, it's a 3 or 4. But yeah, had to talk her down and convince her that it wasn't as bad as she thought. What's interesting to me is well, first of all, just alluding that it was a mysterious phone call. That's weird to me that you'd say a mysterious phone call. But we know the location, Davies said. We have not been able to identify to whom she was speaking. Her friends have no idea who called her.
But in that same paragraph, Sharon goes on to say, "We are convinced something happened at school and her Amherst friends know."
Pure speculation from the mother of Mora's boyfriend, who wasn't even close in proximity to Amherst, Massachusetts. We are to say something like that. What are you trying to get out of? What are you trying to instigate there? What are you trying to get? What fire are you trying to light? We are convinced something happened at school and her Amherst friends know. I mean, no wonder you read this, and no wonder you have armchair detectives that dig deep into this, right? I mean, no wonder you have people who are, they love the true crime and the mystery, and they read that, "We are convinced something happened at school and her Amherst friends know."
It could be just Sharon trying to make sure that her friends were being honest. I mean,
oh, sure. Oh, yeah. Whatever the motivation was, I don't know. Like I said, I'm not sure what fire she was trying to light right there. But look at what a statement like that can lead into, what it can grow into and develop into. And then you have what you have now.
Do you have any closing thoughts?
You and I have talked about this for the past year or so that you guys have been doing this podcast. And you tell me the same answer every time I tell you that Mora went missing at the wrong time, right? And your comeback is always, well, when is there a good time to go missing? And I would argue that, unfortunately, she disappeared at a time that was just prior to the social media age that we now live in. Certainly, you know, her location's an issue. We know that it was a small town in the White Mountains. But yeah, I think if she had disappeared, even, you know, 5 or 6 years later, I think this would have been a different case.
All of these articles have been compiled with great detail and much efficiency and a lot of passion by our buddy Dan, and we will put the link to these articles so you can follow them along when you listen to the episode, or you can peruse them on your own. lots and lots and lots of good information, early information here. So we'll put the link to this in the show notes.
Thank you, everyone, for listening. And thank you to Chris Peek for joining us on this episode. Chris, where can we find your work?
The easiest place is probably just Twitter, at Chris Peek.
And thank you very much to Hunt a Killer. Check them out.